Hey, good morning, San Diego. Welcome to another episode of The American Dream. Hope you got a fresh cup of coffee because I got a great show lined up for you. As you know, my goal with every show is to educate, empower, and engage your American dream. So here's what we have going on today. We got Ryan Ponfer. This guy is a wealth of knowledge. He's a very charitable guy. He's going to discuss ways that he is helping corporations become more charitable to build culture and to grow. Pretty awesome message in today's world where the game has changed for these big companies. Also, we're going to be going to Mission Valley, and we're going to be discussing what's coming up on 9/11, a charity there, and the beer festival that hits San Diego coming up on September 23rd. We got David Stone and Rachel Cano who are going to join us, and we're going to talk about drinking some beer. So great show lined up for you. Let's go ahead and get this thing started right now.
Every single day, you are consumed with information. With the 24/7 negative news cycle and a pop culture that's polluting the airwaves, all selling out the ratings game. Well, guess what? There's a more positive way to look at life. You live in the greatest city in the greatest country on the planet. Every day with our elite network of professionals, our goal is to educate, empower, and engage. And now it's time to fight for your American dream.
All right, welcome to The American Dream. So today's word is Colin Kaepernick. This guy's been in the headlines recently, and it's because he sits out the national anthem, which to me is an utter disgrace. If you don't follow me on social media, you're going to see that I put two words, complete disgrace. You should never burn the American flag, and you should never sit through the national anthem. I don't care what the cause is. Now, in his cause, it's the Black Lives Matter. Now, did he bring more attention to that movement? No, it already has a movement. What he is a washed up quarterback that's not even in the starting lineup. And if the 49ers had any moxie, they would drop the guy. So that is a word on the American dream. Now for a more positive story, the reason we do this show is actually to give you more positive stories, uplifting, overcoming adversity. Today we have an all-star lineup of guests. Really excited for you to see who's going to come in here, empower you some advice. And we're also going out to the field in the East County today. So let's go ahead and get our guests started and start right now.
My name's Kevin Grangetto. I live in Escondido, California, and I have my system put in by Baker Electric Solar. When they got here, they were ready to go. Started early, 6 in the morning. They parked off-site, so they were able to get everything in on the roof, hooked up, and done in a matter of 3 days. And it was really easy for my wife and I to work with them. You just don't want a lot of these challenges to be, you know, affecting the way that you do your life. And when they got in and out of here, it was excellent. It was easy. It's just the way they told me it would be.
All right, now joining us in studio, he is a repeat offender on the American Dream. This guy is a true mover and shaker all over San Diego, one of the most charitable guys I know, and a wealth of knowledge, no pun intended, because he is also a wealth strategist. Ryan Ponsford, good to have you on the show, man.
Always a treat, Craig. Thanks for having me.
So what's the latest? You're always working towards solving world problems. What is the latest?
Yeah, so we're still on saving the world, right? And it's interesting.
You genuinely have a heart for this.
Well, it's funny. So I was on an airplane actually not too long ago to speak at a conference in Denver, and I was sitting there, and there's all this negative news all the time going on, and I was trying to figure out what the heck is going on, and it came down to me that fear. For some reason, we live in a world where everybody's scared. And then I started thinking, what's everybody so freaked out about, right? Mm-hmm. What are we all so scared of? So I started kind of just journaling about it. And then if fear is the issue, what's the opposite of fear, right? And so how do we change that? And so it got me thinking, well, there's courage is sort of the opposite. But then ultimately, it's love and care, right? Okay. And so if you care about people, you tend to not be scared of them. Right, and so how do you teach and promote care in order to offset all the fear that's in the world?
Interesting.
And I realize a lot of the stuff we're doing is right in alignment with that, so it kind of just encouraged me with some of the projects that we have going
on. So, you know, you're definitely right. It's interesting you bring up the media. I try and pick a fight with the mainstream media almost every day here because I just don't think they're doing us any good. When you talk about this fear, isn't that kind of how they thrive, though?
Yeah.
Because fear sells. Well, preying on people's fear sells.
Well, the basic psychology, I think, is roughly 6-1, right? People will respond to fear before they'll respond to optimism or inspiration at about a 6-1 ratio.
By psychology
math.
Well, no wonder our ratings are terrible. No, I'm kidding. But I honestly believe there's a book, and you're a kind of a guru on these business books. There's a book called The Blue Ocean Strategy.
Yep.
And it's when everybody's going one way, you want to go the other way.
Yep.
From a business perspective or personally, professionally. And I think there's a real thirst for opportunity and uplifting statements and overcoming adversity and positive stories. And because of that, I think that message resonates more. I think it's okay to go against the grain when it's 6-1. So what are you guys doing to promote it?
So I couldn't agree more. I think people are starving for something positive and uplifting, and I think the time is ripe for that whole trend to reverse. I think people are over the negative doom and gloom and fear. So a lot of what we're doing, one of the big things we're doing, I'm working with a company right now called Gateway for Good, and the whole concept there is taking this concept of giving and care into corporations. And so we read a bunch of studies around what makes corporations profitable. And there's the simple things that you have to sell stuff and, you know, pay less than you sell it for, and all the simple mathematics of running
margin.
A business, right? Yeah, must have margin. But a lot of the things that people forget about is the true value of your company culture, the engagement of your employees, and then your involvement in community. And now that the kind of theories of this stuff's been out long enough to where there's data to support the revenue impact of those things, and it's literally staggering. When you look at the performance of companies with positive culture, engaged employees, and community engagement, it's amazing what they're doing and how much more profitable they are, and just their general return to shareholders is exponentially higher than those.
So let me have you give a couple examples. You're studying this stuff. What have you seen that represents, without, you don't have to name names, but represents maybe what goes against that? Bad company culture, corporate feel, right? Only paying attention to the margins versus some of the better companies that you've seen that do a great job of lifting people up, empowering their creativity. Give me examples of
Well, I'll tell you, one of the easy things to look at, for some reason, this whole trend is very millennial driven, right? This next generation is it's outwardly a purpose-driven generation, more so than a money-driven generation. And if you look at the generational changes, it's really fascinating. And so they are really forcing companies, I think, to rethink how they treat employees, how they interact in their community and society. And they're literally, they will take less pay, they'll drive farther, they will go a lot of distance in order to be part of a company that's doing positive things in their community and within the company itself.
So what are some good examples that you've seen out there of where companies do a really good job of this stuff?
So I'm trying to think of some locally that are in that space. When you read about it, you hear about more of the technology companies.
Yep.
Are certainly the ones that seem to be leading the Googles. And, you know, I don't know if Apple's there. I don't know enough about their
culture.
I was
in San Francisco about a month ago, and a friend of mine works for one of those tech companies. And he invited us upstairs, and I was fascinated by it. They had a pool table. They had a tap for beer and coffee. They had a room where people could jam out, like so guitar, drums, all this cool stuff. A Red Bull cooler, which, you know, I get it.
Feed them Red Bull, yeah.
And my friend said that people will stay there till like midnight on Fridays, and they'll be getting work done but hanging out. And people will eat lunch there. And I looked at it, I was like, man, this is so inspirational, because don't you spend so much time in an office, whatever you do. As a company leader, don't you want that time to be enjoyable? Don't you get the most out of people when you try and create that environment? So I saw it firsthand in San Francisco, and to me that was really impressive in the tech companies.
Yeah, and you've kind of seen that with our space. We tried to do it, and our whole theory was we probably spend more waking hours in our office a lot of times than we do at home. And so how do you create this home environment where it's, you know, you want it to be comfortable but not sleepy?
Yeah.
So, you know, there is a balance of that where you want to be energized, you want it to be energetic, not just a place where you screw around.
Yeah.
You know, so there is an interesting balance of that, and I think that is driven by, you know, the people that are there. You know, the space certainly has an impact on that, but it's a mentality, it's a way of thinking. If we're here to produce and do awesome stuff, but at the same time we're here to be balanced and understand how we're productive. And people that take that time and do those things tend to be way more productive, you know, in their actual
working
hours.
Yeah, and I should mention, I've actually been to your guys' office, and I think it is a great illustration of everything we're talking about. So you actually, when you're not coming on TV shows, being a star on the media, you're a wealth strategist, so you actually empower people in their lives. They meet with you at your office. What's some good advice for today?
So our big thing that we really do with people is it's, we tend to work with people that have had some financial success, and what tends to happen is they've done well financially, but they're not sure really what's their thing. What am I here to do? I've sold a company, I've done well, or I'm about to sell a company, but then what?
Not fulfilled, maybe.
Yeah, there's this gap. I mean, money doesn't fill your gap, right?
No.
People think it will, it doesn't. I mean, it's hard if you have none, but there's kind of this inverted curve of it, you know, gets better and then it plateaus, and then most people it gets worse once you cross another threshold. And parenting's the same way, interestingly enough. Just read that in another great book.
But different topic.
Yeah, different topic. Don't take me down the cul-de-sac. But so a lot of it is really helping people identify with what's my thing, right? What is my purpose, my calling, and how can my money be a supporter for that? So we love strategy. So we will take, whether it's a business or a family, and design out strategy. What's our outcome? Where are we trying to get? What's the ultimate destination? What does this look like done? What's our vision? And then we design the whole strategy to get there, which is a ton of fun. We map things out on whiteboards, we build steps and processes, and then get granular on what step, each single step that we're gonna go through, so they have the confidence that they'll get there and the peace of mind that they'll be okay online.
Love it, man. Well, I hope people can connect with you online. I think you guys got a great story. I've really enjoyed getting to know you and watching you guys grow and all the things that you're out there doing. Akili Capital, you can find these guys online. I wish you could stick around for the next segment.
I'll watch you guys and...
You should. We're talking craft beer.
I can't go wrong now. I used to volunteer for their thing years ago when I worked at the bank and had a ton of fun. It's a really cool event that they do. It's probably way bigger now than it was when we were there. But
thousands of people.
Back
so
in the good old days.
We're bringing in David Stone from downtown and Rachel Cano, and we're talking about the craft beer festival that's coming up. So this is a San Diego story. Should be fun. Stick around.
Hi, my name is Steve, and this is my wife, Amy. We just had our solar panels installed by Baker Electric. Living out here in the East County, the temperatures can be in the mid-70s to over 100.
We didn't know a lot about solar. Speaking with our solar consultant, he was there to answer any of our questions that we had. He was always there when we needed him.
I think the fact that Baker does go in-house with their employees, everyone is very professional and very polite, and they're on budget. We couldn't have gone with a better company.
All right, welcome back to the show. Now we're going to discuss a topic that is near and dear to my heart, craft beer. I don't know if it necessarily has to be craft beer, but David Stone, president of Greater Good Realty, joins us. Good to have you on the show, David.
Nice to be here. Thank you.
And Rachel Cano, who you've been doing this San Diego Beer Festival for 22 years.
That's correct. Thank you for having us, Craig.
That's pretty fascinating. So David, you helped bring Rachel in here. You guys have a relationship. We got the beer festival coming up on September 23rd. Mm-hmm. What's your role in it?
Well, actually, I found out about this organization a couple years ago, and I believe you know, we actually do a lot of giving back from my real estate brokerage, and so I always try to find really deserving local charities that are doing a great job of raising money and giving back to the local community. So what could be more fun than raising money and going outside on Broadway Pier and drinking beer? So it's a great event, and I had a great time last year as being a sponsor as well.
So my understanding is 100% of your proceeds go to charity.
Absolutely. We're a nonprofit organization, so we're all volunteers. So we were founded as San Diego Professionals Against Cancer, and all of our volunteers come in to help out for this one-day event, and then we get to choose where the money's going to go, and that's also interesting. Who has the greater need? And we've partnered with Rady's Children's Hospital and given them thousands of dollars over the years.
So you guys really decide where you want the partnership to be for the event and the money you're raising?
That's correct.
Awesome. So you've been doing this 22 years. You've had a different allocation every year?
Every year is a different allocation. Every year we look to see where there's a need. The Emilio Nares Foundation last year had a great need, and so we gave to the Emilio Nares Foundation as well as the Children's Hospital.
Well, good for you. That's awesome. And the good news is you're doing it in a fun way, right? This is a good way for people to get out and enjoy America's finest city. It's a beer festival. So tell us about the event, what we should expect, how we can sign up, starting with what do we expect? I haven't been to one of these before. So tell us about it.
Well, this is at the Broadway Pier. And if you haven't been to the Broadway Pier, it's an amazing location. It's right on the water. It's beautiful. The pavilion is in the middle. And we'll have about 60 breweries that each brewery is bringing two different kinds of beer. And there'll be food. There's live music. There's a radio station. There'll be a DJ in what we consider three separate areas of the pier. And it's just a fun event. We have volunteers that pour the beer. The brewers are there to talk about the beer. And we just enjoy the event and raise money.
I bet you've seen an evolution over the years of doing a beer festival with what's happened with the emergence of craft beer.
Absolutely.
I doubt you had 60 brewers always there giving two different beers, 120 different beers to sample.
Absolutely. So let me tell you that Carl Strauss and A.L. Smith, local San Diego's, were at our first beer festival in 1994, and they've been with us ever since. So going on year 22, Ale Smith and Carl Strauss will still be with us. So that's been a great partnership with them all of these years. But you're right, there are a lot of breweries that have come up and no longer exist. Stone didn't exist in our first year. And now there, I think there are about 130 breweries, craft breweries
in San
Diego.
Isn't it fascinating? Are you into the beer scene as well, David? You're obviously into the real estate downtown and helping charities, but I mean, you've been in San Diego for a while.
Yep, and it's funny, I'm not a big beer drinker, but I remember last year, and I don't know the brewer's name, but they had birthday cake beer. I forget what the name of it was. So it was like a sweet beer.
Did you try it?
I did. I was actually my favorite one, probably because it was a sweet tasting beer. But it is so interesting. And in addition to beer, I know there's entertainment, there's a live stage going on. And one thing too, I just want to add, I know Rachel mentioned raising thousands of dollars. We're talking hundreds of thousands of dollars over the 22 years. So, getting closer and closer to the $1 million mark here in the near future. So it's a big event and a big fundraiser.
Well, anytime you can balance fun and raising money and charity, but also doing it the right way, which a lot of charities, they present a certain way, but what happens behind the scenes is a little troubling. You guys actually are very clean. All of your money goes towards the charity you choose. It's all volunteers. And again, this I think will be a lot of fun. What I think is so neat about the craft beer scene here in San Diego is that it's a phenomenal story. You know, it's like the manufacturers created these watered down beers because it's cheaper and inexpensive. And now craft beer is treated like a fine wine. I mean, in some of these areas, and
absolutely,
some of these companies are selling for billions of dollars. Yep. It's unbelievable. Yep. So if people want to go to the event, they want to sign up, sponsor maybe, where would they go?
They could go to our website. We're still looking for volunteers, either to help with the day of, logistics for the day of, or to pour beer. And they can sign up online. We're selling tickets. Actually, the ticket prices go up on September 1st. Sponsors, we're always looking for sponsors, and there's information
on the website. So this is actually going to be on September 23rd.
Correct.
And the website that people can go to is sdbeerfest.org, is that right?
Correct.
David, since I got you here, I have to do this to you, and I know you're probably avoiding it, but top producing realtor downtown, 92101, do big things there. I know you cover other areas as well, but you know, you got this great image behind you of America's finest city. How is the downtown market? What's the hustle and bustle like? How are buyers and sellers behaving right now?
It's still very similar to the rest of the county in that there's low inventory, low interest rates, and I wish there was more cranes downtown that were actually building condos versus hotels and apartments.
So there are a lot of these cranes. You drive into downtown, I mean, it looks like a lot of building is going on, but a lot of these aren't.
No, there's only two condo buildings right now that are actually under construction. So
only two of these cranes are condos.
Yep, that's it. That's
why
it.
Why not? So what's the catch here? Why are not more homes being built to keep up with the demand?
You know, I think because the rental market is also so strong and accelerating so fast that a lot of the bigger corporations they're doing their ROIs and determining that it makes sense to build the apartment buildings. But at the same time, a lot of those apartment buildings are being built to condo specs that could be converted at any given time.
So just to make sure this makes sense to our viewers, so they could go and they could build the condos. What they're doing is they're building the apartments, and ultimately those apartments could down the road be converted to be sold to market.
Yeah, absolutely.
Interesting. Well, it's a heck of a marketplace. You're doing huge things down there. And I want to remind our audience that not only is David a top producing realtor, but he donates commission to charities. You can visit him online. It's greatergoodrealty.com. David, thank you so much for coming on. Thank you, Rachel, for doing so much for a great cause and making it a lot of fun. So coming up next, earlier you heard me say that beer is near and dear to my heart, which is kind of a fun statement, but truly one of the most dear things to my heart is 9/11. All of us remember that day, and it's still something that we can do a lot for. So earlier this week, we were out with Jeff Whittington in Mission Valley and our co-host Jen Morris, and we talked about things happening with our fire department and an upcoming charity for 9/11. I hope you can stick around and check this out. It is something that I'm going to be doing, and I encourage you to as well. So let's go see what they had to say for 9/11.
We're here at Fire Station 45 in Mission Valley, right across from Qualcomm Stadium, and I'm joined by real estate specialist Jeff Whittington. Thank you so much for having us
here,
Jeff.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
Now, this is your home away from home. You used to be a firefighter. Tell us a little bit about that.
So I was a firefighter with the city of San Diego, firefighter paramedic for 7 years. I left in August of 2013 and went full-time real estate agent.
Into real estate. That seems absolutely. Like quite a jump.
It was a bit of a transition, but it's been a family business for a long time. Father was a developer, grandfather was a developer, so I'd seen it and watched it my whole life, and so it made a relatively easy transition into it.
It was in your blood.
I guess it was in the blood, yes.
Tell us a little bit about what it was like for you when you were a firefighter.
It's an incredible career, and I still just have so much respect for the people who do it every day. It's definitely challenging. You see a lot of things, you do a lot of things that I think most people don't even realize. But it's incredibly rewarding, and the portion of people's lives that you get to be a part of, you can really make a difference, and I think you tend to feel that every day when you come to work. So.
Well, firefighters certainly are past and present American heroes, as are Absolutely. Their families. There's so much sacrifice that goes on, I'm sure.
Agreed.
Tell us how your experience as a firefighter has really given you, you know, what you all the attributes you have right now for your real estate business.
Well, I think that, you know, as a firefighter, I think that the department runs, it's an honesty, it's an integrity type of career and position, and I brought that right over into my profession, and that's what my core values are, the honesty and integrity of my business, making sure that I'm giving my clients the best of me, and really holding to what we dedicated ourselves to as firefighters, which is to be helpful, to be there to make a difference, and that's what I'm trying to do. It's a different type of experience, and it's still rewarding. It's not life or death situations, but it's definitely you have the opportunity to make a significant impact in people's lives, and so that's what I've carried over with me.
Absolutely. You really are the firefighter's real estate agent. You said that it makes up almost 75% of your business.
So about 75% of my business has been with current firefighters and or family members, relatives, people that they've referred over. So it has made up a large portion of it. So.
Well, let's talk about why we're here. There is a cause that is near and dear to your heart. Tell us about this.
Well, the 9/11 Memorial Stair Climb that's here in San Diego is an event that's put on every year by some amazing firefighters and some amazing people to benefit Firefighters Aid, which is a program that assists firefighters and their families locally that are in a time of need, whether that's a cancer diagnosis or a death or a disability. And the event, the people who've organized it and developed it are really passionate about it, and it's just a great cause, and the benefit is incredible. So it's an opportunity for people to get involved, come out and have some fun, and so that's why I've brought a couple people here to talk a little bit more about it and just show us what it's all about.
Bring on?
So I brought on Carly One and Justin Herzog. Carly is the Director of Development for Firefighter Aid, which is where those funds from the 9/11 stair climb go to. And Justin Herzog is a local San Diego City firefighter.
That's so exciting. I can't wait to hear what they have to say.
So Carly One, Director of Development for Firefighter Aid, and Justin Herzog, current firefighter for San Diego. 9/11 stair climb. So Firefighter Aid, can you tell us a little bit about that, the program, what it benefits, and that the event for that day?
Absolutely. So Firefighter Aid is a local San Diego-based charity that aids firefighters and their families in time of need. That's pretty much whatever they need, we're here for them. The San Diego 9/11 Memorial Stair Climb event is our one event that we do. Some charities do a gala every year. This is our gala, if you will. We aim to raise $100,000, and we're getting close to our goal. We just hit $67,000 today, so we're 3 weeks out from the event, and I have a feeling we're going to be able to hit that goal for the first time this year. Really excited about it. You can still register for the event. We have 1,300 spaces. There's still a few open. The climb is on Saturday, September 10th, down at the San Diego Hilton Bayfront Hotel. And we've got food trucks, beer garden, Steppin' Feet is our band. So after the event, after everyone climbs and we honor those who lost their lives on 9/11, we turn it into a celebration of patriotism and just what it is to be American.
So I know it's a really great and fantastic family event. A lot of things for the kids to do there. And I think one of the things that's really neat for the kids is to see all the firefighters who are there climbing in their full gear. And Justin, maybe you can kind of give us a little idea of what that's like for you, the weight of the gear, and what that experience is.
Sure. Well, for firefighters, first and foremost, we're honoring the fallen. We're honoring our heroes by climbing these stairs. We're finishing the climb that they were unable to finish. So for us, it means a ton, you know. Our relationship with each other is so tight. And, you know, when we lost all those firefighters and all those first responders on 9/11, it was a life-changing event for so many of us. So to be there honoring them is obviously very important to us, but also to share that with our families and our friends. And when the kids are there and they're watching us dressed up in our gear and climbing the stairs, and it's a workout. It's definitely not easy. It's hot in the stairwell. It's 50 to 80 pounds of extra weight that's on us based on what's in our turnouts and whether we're wearing our SCBA or carrying a tool or a hose pack or whatever. And so they get to be there to share it with us. And we're proud. We're proud to be there to honor the fallen and also to support the brave that are still doing it and to interact with the families and friends that are there.
Incredible event. And tell us really quick, how many floors is everyone climbing?
Well, our climbing is 110 flights. With the Hilton, it's not a 110-story sure. building, so we're making it work so that it's equal to 110 flights. And like I said, it is hot in the stairwell. It's not easy. It's a good workout, and it's great for us as firefighters. We need to be prepared to be able to do that. So it's a good opportunity for us to train and get ready for it, and then to share that event.
And if for those that are interested in signing up or want to learn more about it, where should they go?
SanDiegoStairClimb.com. And it's, if you don't want to climb, you can volunteer, you can still fundraise, and it's, the event is free. So it's open to the public. The kids zone is free, all that good stuff is free. So just come down, and the beer's not free, but.
Sure. But there is a beer garden.
But there is a beer garden, so.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Justin, Carly, thank you. Thanks. I'm sure it's going to be a successful event.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
You just heard from real estate expert Jeff Whittington and his special guest today about the 9/11 San Diego Memorial Stair Climb event. To learn more about this event, go on SanDiegoStairClimb.com. I'm Jen Morris for the American Dream.
All right, hope you enjoyed today's show. That is all for today. Earlier today on The Word, you heard me talk about Colin Kaepernick, who is sitting down through the national anthem. You know, I'd love to get your thoughts on this. You watch our show called The American Dream. We're pretty patriotic here, and that's not politically motivated. I don't care if you're conservative or a liberal. There's something to be said about standing up for your country, the national anthem, the flag, all that our military does. I would just like to hear your comments on it. Am I right? Am I wrong? Does a free speech First Amendment protect it? You tell me. Go to contact Craig at CraigSewing.com. By hitting that form, it emails me directly, and maybe we'll read your comments out. Contact Craig at CraigSewing.com. And while you're there, follow us on social media. You can do it right from your smartphone. So Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, we're active on all of it. Follow us on social media. And of course, set your DVR because we're going to be back here again tomorrow right here on Channel 4 at 10:30, empowering your American dream. Have a great one.